and welcome to our service of worship. I dropped my thingy. So, as we gather ourselves today, let's say these words and think on these words. No, it says end at service, is that all right? Yeah. Let's think on these words together. Is the clicker work? Thank you. Hear these words of invitation. Welcome to the joyful. May you be able to share that joy here. Welcome to the tired and weary. May you find rest here. Welcome to the lonely. May you find community here. Welcome to the sick. May you find healing here. Welcome to those who mourn. May you find comfort here. Welcome to the foreigner, to the stranger, to the refugee. May you find safety here. Welcome to every nation, every race, every sexual orientation, every gender identity. May you find hospitality here. The God who delights in all of creation is in our midst. Thanks be to God. Amen. And let's stand to sing.
Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. mountains and the sea. Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love comes down. Yeah, I could sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, by the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing when your love comes down. I would sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. Oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know. When the whole world's seen the light, they will dance for joy, just like we're dancing now. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
Glory.
I'm a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Boom. Thank you. Please be seated. For our readings. Yes. Yes, oh sorry, yes, children. Sorry, I forgot about the important people. I do apologize.
Good morning. Our reading this morning is from James 2, and it's verses 1 to 7, warning against partiality. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, have a seat here, please, while to the other one who is poor you say, stand there or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters, has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you?
Sorry. Do you know you can't get the workers, can you, really? Right. Okay. Sorry, I've got to rearrange all this lot down here. Yeah. Right. Okay. I've got a bit of a husky voice because I've had a cough, but I'm not catching, so don't worry. All right. So let's pray then. Lord Jesus, we pray that everyone who hears the words I'm about to speak needs to hear them, and that you have been working in their hearts as you work in my heart, so to bring us to this place today. We ask your blessing upon each one of us that's here and on each one who is unable to be here. Teach us, Lord, and help us to live a better life. Amen. Amen. Morning, everyone. Anyway. Can anybody tell me, and I'm hoping, now I think this is going to be wrong, was there an 11 o'clock service last week? No. Well, you should have been there if there was, maybe. No, right, okay. Well, last week, Hannah talked about something, and I can't ask you if you know what she talked about, because you obviously weren't here because there wasn't a service. So what it was about being open and accepting each other without judgment. It was about judgmentalism. Yes, all right. Well, if you went to that, you'll know then. It was about, you know, judge not, lest ye judge. Thanks, Stefan, for that. Well, as I was listening to what Hannah was saying last week to us at the 9:30, I must admit I was feeling a bit guilty because I had been judging people quite a lot that week with respect to the significant number of people who had lost their lives at sea, if you remember. One ship which sank near Greece, filled with hundreds of men, women, and children, received little help, and their deaths seemed only to capture a few hours of news time and a day's worth of newspaper. On the other hand, the destruction of the sub, taking five people down to the Titanic, was reported for a week with hundreds of people involved in a rescue attempt costing millions, and with endless interviews about every detail that transpired. Now, I'm looking at it from my point of view. You may have a different point of view. But how their stories were revealed and how they were dealt with was very much in line with the world's value system, as opposed to God's. Anna was angry on behalf of the poor people, who seemed to have been treated very differently from those who had wealth. But when faced with situations like these, we do need to be very careful, because we don't know the full story or what goes on behind the scenes. We're only told by the news what we need to be told. Although it's important to stand up for what we think is right, it's easy to become judgmental and to feel righteous. But it's not our place to do that. It wasn't my place to do that, because we're all far from perfect. And consequently, what we can do is pray and give each situation to the one who is perfect, God, because that's his job. Both events were horrendous tragedies, and we mourn with their families and friends. But one thing we do know is that each one of those people was a child of God, regardless of their wealth, faith, or status, and were equally loved by him as we all are. I know I've often said this before, but it's amazing how humanity and its behavior never really changes over time. And that's especially true when we make judgments about others and then treat them accordingly. It was happening in the time of the Bible. It happens now. The first verse of this, James chapter 2, is, "My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ?" It's a new church. They're starting to find their feet, what they're doing. So James is trying to say to them, these congregations were now made up of people from all social groups. The salvation of Jesus had broken through the long-held divisions in society, and people would find themselves talking to and living in contact with others who were very different to themselves. Where there'd been strict distinctions between the classes of rich and poor, now the dynamic had changed, and it would take time for the new way of life to become the norm. We know from the many letters sent out at that time to the new churches that similar problems needed to be dealt with. At one point, the Greek widows were not being looked after properly, which caused a scandal, and new administration was put into place to make sure that they weren't left out in future. It's not surprising there were teething problems at the start, because God was developing a completely new society and a different way of living in the light of Jesus' death and resurrection. In this first verse, James is questioning the behavior and faith of church members because people were judging each other. And this resulted in acts of favoritism, or as the reading said, partiality. We think the judging, and then we act with the favoritism. It was a far cry from the teaching of equality for all. When we get judgmental about people, and remember, I'm talking about myself as much as I'm talking to anybody, often it's because we don't think they're living up to our standards. I feel so sorry for Mark, you know, it's just difficult. So we look down on them, but I would never look down on him, bless him. But sometimes our judgmentalism tells us that others are better than we are, so that leads us to feeling that we're worthless, hurt, and we're resentful. Being better or inferior, neither scenario is right, and in both instances, we're listening to our ego and not to God. One Bible commentator said this: whether we think we're superior to someone else or somehow inferior, the problem is that we're being judgmental, and that affects our behavior and the way in which we treat people, and that can lead us into trouble. In verse 1, it sounds as if James is challenging the very sincerity of their faith in Jesus. Can you really call yourselves Christians if you show favoritism to one person and disdain to another. He calls for them and us to show the authenticity of our faith by the way we treat people with fairness and impartiality. This applies to friends and family, workmates, and those we pass in the street. Thinking of how we should regard those on the street and those who walk off the street and into our churches for the first time, I'd like to bring two books to your attention. Both books are written by a woman called Raina Wynne, and you may have seen them. One of them is called The Salt Path, came out in 2018, and the latest one, The Wild Silence, in 2020. The books were discussed by the Diocesan Book Club. I bet you didn't know there was a Diocesan Book Club. Well, there is. If you go online, digital online learning thing, you'll find all sorts of interesting things that you can do. You don't have to be ordained or anything. And they do have a book club, virtual book club. And these were the books that they'd used. The books are centred on the decision made by Raina and her husband Moth to walk the 630-mile southwest coastal path. They must have been mad. But there was a reason. The couple had become homeless after a bad investment, and then her husband was diagnosed with a terminal illness causing muscular degeneration. Almost everything upon which their lives were based was swept from under their feet, a bit like the early church. So in the state of shock, they decided to walk and to live independently as long as they could because of Moth's illness. It's a story of human strength, endurance. It covers themes of loss, new beginnings, good and bad, homelessness, poverty, hunger, wild camping, you name it, it does it. It's awe-inspiring. I've only got halfway through it and it's amazing. And as they walk, they become one with nature and develop an ability to survive all sorts of things, whilst the fresh air and the physical activity keeps Moth going and his condition begins to improve. So one of the book people said, where's God in this then? This is a diocesan book club. Well, Raina says at the outset, I don't believe in God. But like a lot of the times we say, I don't believe in that. And then she says, but if he does exist, he's just grabbed the roots of my life and ripped them from the ground and turned my very existence upside down. But as they continue to travel, they develop a spiritual understanding of the land, the earth, which could well be expressed as a thin place where man can be close to the other world, to God's realm. And it's here where they find God's realm through their interaction with good people and in God's creation. Not the normal way, maybe, of coming to faith, but it was there. The novel is full of encounters with, for the most part, kindly and generous strangers. But here comes the judgment partiality bit from those who should have known better. The two openly Christian encounters in these books are not kindly in their attitude to homelessness or those without a traditional Christian faith. The couple are seen as feckless and unkempt, despite their ability to show generosity of spirit and an open, trusting nature to all they came across. Pray God we never knowingly treat those who come into our church seeking God in such a manner. James explains that one thing is clear: favoritism based on judgmentalism within the church is a sin. It's not about a building or the hierarchy of the church. It's the attitude of the people who claim to be the body of Christ. And that's us. We move on to verses 2-4. James explains this concept further. For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and says, here, have a seat here, please, on the top table. Or while the one to who is poor, you say, no, stand over there. Or sit down at my feet, which was a terrible insult in those days, because you never let people near your feet, because that was the dirtiest part of your body. He said, you are making distinctions among yourself, and you've become judges with evil thoughts. That's a bit of a sting, isn't it? The implication is that assumptions are being made about these two people based on their appearance, probably their personal hygiene, and how affluent they look like. Decisions are being made as to where they will be appropriately seated. Have we ever done that? Have we ever seen it done? Have we put people in out-of-the-way seats because they're a bit smelly or because they exhibit unusual behaviour? Or we don't know how to deal with who they are? And we don't really know who they are because we probably haven't even talked to them yet. I really hope we don't do that. But we're not perfect. James says we shouldn't make any distinctions because showing partiality to one person or another divides the community. It's one body of Christ. Playing favorites tears apart that body and damages our witness to the world. Besides, when we show favor to the rich at the expense of the poor, we're going against everything that Jesus taught. But this scenario was obviously happening enough to warrant a timely reminder, i.e. the letter, to the church members that they were sliding back into their old ways of behaving. Because let's remember, all these people that he's talking to were probably the poor. The church did a lot for the poor because they'd never had rights before. There were few rich people in the church because they had a lot to lose, their status and sometimes their money. They were sliding back into behaving deferential to rich people. And that should never, there should never be a question of pulling social rank in a church. Indeed, in behaving this way, they were allowing the world to leave its dirty smudge on them. Yes, dirty smudge. They're the exact words used at the end of James chapter 1, so don't think I made it up. It's there, the last verse in James 1. He's talking about how we allow the world to leave its taint upon us, its dirty smudge. But we all have dirty smudges. I've got one sat over there who comes in every day coated in mud from the allotment, from gilking after the bees. He tells me to say these things because he likes to be talked about in the sermons. But let's be serious. We all have dirty smudges. We collect them as we move through an imperfect world. The key is to recognize that they're there and that with prayer and the grace of God, we can stop them from sticking. If we don't keep cleaning out our sins or the way that we have our attitudes, it just overwhelms us eventually. Somebody said to me in the earlier service, she said, I'm so glad you said that, and I'm not saying this because, but she said, I have been judging something all week. And she said, it's making me hurt. And that's what it does. It hurts other people and it hurts us. Finally, we come to the last few verses of our reading where James talks specifically about the poor. Most of his audience were poor, as I've said. In most examples of favoritism we have looked at, it's always the poor who often come off worse. Throughout Scripture, we find repeatedly that God honours the oppressed and not the oppressors. Here in verse 5, James says, has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he's promised to those who love him? God cares about the poor. God has always cared about the poor. But the world is always assessing people, sizing them up, putting them down, and establishing a pecking order. So instead of following the world's value system, a system that often makes the rich richer and the poor poorer, we need to follow God and his system, who sees and loves all and wants the church to reflect that generous and universal love in its behavior to everyone, outside of the doors of the church and inside the doors of the church. This points us towards the central idea of Jesus' teaching, to love God first and then to love your neighbor as yourself. However, it isn't really about us, is it? It's all about loving others, raising others, the ones in fine clothes as much as the ones in smelly rags. When we show God's favor to each person we meet, and we recognize each one as being someone God loves deeply, we become part of something beyond ourselves. But as our faith builds and our love for God grows deeper, we will find the one person, and we find that favoring one person over the other makes no sense anymore. God has showered his favor on us all, so we can share it with anyone who reaches out to us. Rich and poor, young and old, powerful and powerless, in whichever church or part of the city we find ourselves. God has no favorites for each of us in God's own beloved child, and we're part of the kingdom of God. So let's pray. Actually, it's not a pray. It's a sort of, I've called it thoughts, all right? It's sort of trying to think about our dirty smudges that might be hanging on somewhere that's stopping us from being the full potential that we have. So I'm just going to say six thoughts. It won't take long. I just want you to think about it, to meditate on it. Close your eyes if you want to pray about them. And if there's one that stays in your mind after we've finished, then perhaps that's the one that God needs to help you with his grace and his forgiveness later in the week or throughout the week. So let's have these thoughts. Has anything made you angry this week? If so, are you sure you're not being judgmental? Give it to God. What can we do to make our greetings to newcomers be more welcoming? Do we always leave it to the hosts? Give it to God. Do you think it's easy to be judgmental? If so, why? Give it to God. Can you remember a time when you were openly judged? How did you feel? Give it to God. Have you ever seen anyone show favoritism in this church or any other church? Give it to God. Do you find it difficult to accept everyone as a beloved Christ, child of Christ and God? And if you do, why do you think that is? Give it to God. Lord Jesus, we ask for your grace and the Spirit to teach us what we need to remove from our hearts, what smudges we need to remove that is a barrier for us opening out and reaching out to others, whether coming into church or whether we're meeting them in the streets day by day. We ask for your Spirit to enlighten us and to give us strength to keep on removing those smudges of and taints of the world so that we can live in harmony with each other and with you. Amen.
Just before we continue in prayer, I wanted to share with you something. My friend is a vicar and she just moved into a new parish and she's been getting to know her parishioners. And she visited an older gentleman yesterday who showed her his prayer book that he'd been given as a young child. And that was over 80 years ago. And it's got this beautiful little bit in it which says, if the service seems long or dull, try and mean some of the prayers and hymns. You will find more to, than that meets the eye. And then there's a section called Daily Prayers. And it says, you must keep in touch with your leader. The reason why disaster befell many Russian ships in the Japanese war was that they got out of touch with their leader. They then got all into confusion. Some ships rammed ships of their own side. Some fired on their friends. Some blew themselves up on their minds. Keep in touch with your God. Some men get out of touch and there is confusion. They are a danger to their comrades. They bring their own friends to disaster and blow themselves up on their own minds. So say your prayers daily, for it is not so much that you have got things to ask for as that you go into the presence of your Lord. So let's pray and be in that presence. Saviour of the world, be present in all places of suffering, violence and pain, and bring hope even in the darkest night. We pray for all areas where there is conflict, globally in Ukraine, France and Myanmar. Nationally and locally, we pray for all those affected by conflict in communities, whether long-standing or recent. Lord, bringer of peace, be alongside those who work to prevent and reduce conflict. Give them strength so they're not overwhelmed with the magnitude of their task. Inspire us to continue your work of reconciliation today, in our communities and in our relationships. Grant us the wisdom to become peacemakers in all places and in all things. Help us to welcome all, whoever they are. Help us to see your beauty in everyone. Healing God, stretch out your hand to bring comfort, wholeness and peace to all who suffer in body, mind or spirit. Fill us with compassion that we may be channels of your healing love. In a moment of quiet, we bring before you all who we know are suffering. Be their source of strength, be their guide through the pain. Bring us alongside those who need your healing spirit. Jesus, conqueror of death, remember for good those whom we love but we see no longer. Help us to live this day in the sure and certain hope of your eternal victory. Bring comfort to those who mourn, and bring us to those who need your grace and everlasting love. Forgiving, Lord, we bring those times we have failed to you, the times we've listened but not heard, where we have acted without thinking, where we have spoken without you in our hearts. Forgive us and renew us. Amazing God, everywhere we walk, let it be on your path. Everything we see, let it be through your eyes. Everything we do, let it be your will. When we face hardship, let us place it in your hands. We do not know where we are going, but we know that you are there first to guide and strengthen us. Help us to let go of the past, of the sins and harms that have entangled us, of the bad habits we can't break, of the fears and anxieties that follow us, of those judgments that leave those dirty smudges on our hearts. Make all things new in our life and help us to live in glory that is your presence. We give thanks for the beauty of this day, this hour, this minute. Help us to remember that we are in the church to make a better place for Jesus Christ's sake. Help us to keep in touch with you, Lord, our leader. Keep us rooted in you so there is no confusion in our hearts, that we do not harm others, and that we do not sabotage ourselves. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we bring those prayers together as we move on now to our Lord's Prayer. We say that together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let's stand to sing this song, All the Poor and Powerless. Thank you.
all the poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely, all the thieves will come confess, and know that you are holy, and know that you are holy. And all will sing out hallelujah, we will cry out hallelujah. And all the hearts who are content, all who feel unworthy, and all who hurt with nothing left, will know that you are holy, and all will sing out hallelujah, we will cry out hallelujah. Shout it, come on and sing it from the mountains, come on and tell it to the people that he is God. Shout it, go sing it from the mountains, go on and tell it to the people that he is God. Shout it, go on and sing it from the mountains, tell it to the people that he is God. Shout it, go on and sing it from the mountains, go on and tell it to the people that he is God. And all will sing out hallelujah, we will cry out hallelujah. And all will sing out hallelujah, we will cry out hallelujah.
Please be seated.
Last week, 9:30, all signed up because we're looking for prayer volunteers for CAP. All we're asking for is people to commit to pray for the work of CAP, to support Nick and Viv. She's Vivian, I'm Viv, so we don't get confused, his wife. It's a sheet here, I'll be out the back. Please just sign your name, put down your information of phone or whatever. They just want to know that there are people out here, from here and out there in the world, supporting their ministry and supporting all the other people that help people who need the work of CAP to come into their lives. It's not about getting you to sign up for things and all that. They just want to know that there is a core of prayer there. And if you sign up, it also gives you the sort of the idea that, well, perhaps I ought to do it because I've written my name on the sheet when we forget to pray. So if you can grab hold of me somewhere out there or up there, please sign up. They'd be very grateful.
Just a couple more notices. So we've got Women's Fellowship in the Emmaus Rooms tomorrow, Monday 3rd of July, and that's 10:30 till 12. And then there's Community Spirit Games, again in the Emmaus Rooms. That's a week on Monday, so that's the 10th of July, again 10:30 till 12. And that's for board games, friendship, tea, coffee and cake afterwards. Shield are meeting tonight in the Emmaus Rooms, 6 till 7:30, and that's years 7 to 11. And that's a creative evening with Andy Owen. And I've got a note saying, we look forward to welcoming you to one of our morning prayer services next Sunday, 9th of July, at the usual time of 9:30 and 11. So I think that means just come to church next week. And finally, two things. One, there's a few courgettes out in the back, because I've massively overestimated how many courgettes my family will eat if I grow them. So please, please do take some. Please do take some. And then can we just have the last slide? Next week, Sunday the 9th of July, there is an event over at the Polka Hop, which for those of you that don't know that one, it used to be O'Dea's, O'Donoghue's, 7:30 till 9:30. It's in Poems and Similar Nonsense with Rob Reed. And Rob's been doing a poem a week across the year, so he's halfway there at the moment, so he's going to do those poems. And we've got support from our very own Phil Asquith as well.
If you're not sick of me on a Sunday morning,
yeah, you can have
you
an additional
come along on a Sunday evening as well.
So do come along to that. It's a really nice evening. Anybody else got any notices? Kath?
Very quickly. I've put quite a lengthy newsletter together, which will be going into the grapevine that's coming out, or whatever we call it these days. But just notification of two fundraisers, really. The first one is an easy one to ask for, because that's a breast cancer afternoon tea that we're hosting at the Spring on the 29th of July from 3 until 5. And we're doing a spring afternoon tea, which we all know is great. It's probably the best you can get. And we are putting a little bit of pink fizz with it. And it's to raise money for breast cancer treatment. I'm sure we all know people who have had that or are going through it. So if you want to support it, tickets go on sale on Tuesday. It's 20 quid, which I know that sounds a lot, but £15 of that will go directly to the breast cancer charity. So that's my first one. The second one is a little more tricky. For those of you who know the Spring, you'll know how busy we are, you know what we do, how many people we serve, but our kitchen is falling to bits. The hob doesn't work. I took a fruitcake home last night to cook because the oven packed in yesterday. There's just numerous things wrong with it. So we are looking to fundraise for the Spring. So I'm coming to you as church family. I'm coming to the wider community. I'm putting it on social media. And I think we need to raise about 15 grand, which that is a lot of money. At the moment, that is a lot of money. I get that. But we want to continue doing what we do. And the kitchen really isn't fit for purpose much. It went in back in 2009. When Rupert, bless him, came to the congregation that time and said, can you give us some money for the Spring, please? So I'm doing it now. The fundraiser will start kind of in the next couple of weeks. You'll see it on Facebook if you follow us. And if anybody wants to donate, because it has to be a donation, anything we will gratefully accept. It can be with your name on it. It can be anonymous. It just needs to happen, really. We're hoping to do it at the end of August. And we have some money in the bank, don't get me wrong. We've got some reserves. We are non-profit making, we are a social enterprise, but I do try and steward God's money well, and we can put some money in the pot, but I just don't have 15,000. So that's my plea, that's my prayer, that you will just support what the Spring does. And hopefully, in September, we will have a brand new kitchen. Not a fancy one, but ovens that work, shelving that doesn't have doors on it that fall off, a water boiler that boils water, and a happy team, really, because we've just got better environment to work in. That's it. I know it's a hard ask. I don't often ask for money, but on this occasion, I am. So there you go. Thanks.
I think the good news about things like that is the church can definitely afford to do it. The problem with that is most of that money is still in your pockets. So if you just leave it in the tray at the back, that would be really, really good. Thank you. Yes, the other thing is we're going a bit Old Testament this afternoon and having a burnt offering, barbecue, sorry. Not a burnt offering, it's a barbecue at the vicarage on Manygates Lane this afternoon. If you want some more details, talk to me after the service. And I think that's it. Can we get rid of that picture now, please? Thank you. It makes me feel bilious. It's back again. Let's stand to sing our last song.
Who is like you, Lord of heaven, King of glory, throne in majesty? You are holy, you are holy. Who can fathom all the riches of your mercy, of your faithfulness? You are worthy, you are worthy. For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the honors of his name. Awake my soul and celebrate the wonders of his grace. Let heaven and earth join in the song.
Who is like you?
Who is like you, Lord of heaven, King of glory, throne in majesty? You are holy, you are holy. Who can fathom all the riches of your mercy, of your faithfulness? You are worthy, you are worthy. For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the honors of his name. Awake my soul and celebrate the wonders of his grace. Let heaven and earth join in the song. You are holy, you are holy.
For you are holy, you are holy. For you are holy, you are holy. For you are holy, you are holy. For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the honor of his name. Awake my soul and celebrate the wonder of his grace. Let heaven and earth join in the song.
Jesus, Lord of time, hold us in your eternity. Jesus, image of God, travel with us the life of faith. Jesus, friend of sinners, heal the brokenness of our world. Jesus, Lord of tomorrow, draw us into your future. Amen. And let's say the grace together and to each other. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Please join us in the Emmaus rooms for refreshments. Thank you.